In this video, we're going to start with our previous result for the electric field due to a ring of charge, and we're going to use this result to find the electric field on the axis of a uniformly charged disk. After finding the electric field for the disk, we're going to investigate a couple limiting cases. First, when we're very close to the disk, we should retrieve the formula for the electric field due to an infinite sheet of charge. And second, when we're very far from the disk, we should see the field of a point charge. And that large X approximation comes with a special bonus in this video. We actually have to use the binomial approximation to get this done. As always, this video is divided into short chapters if you want to skip around, and let's get started. So as a quick reminder, the electric field on the axis of a uniformly charged ring is given by Qx over 4 pi epsilon 0 times the quantity x squared plus big R squared to the 3/2 power, where x is the distance from the center of the ring, Q is the charge on the ring, and big R is the radius of the ring. And I'll post a link at the top to the video where that was derived. So on the right-hand side, we have a uniformly charged disk with charge capital Q, radius big R, and we're observing the field at a distance of x from the center of the disk and located on the symmetry axis of the disk. And our strategy here is to break this disk into thin rings of charge, each with a radius of little r, a charge of dq, and a thickness that we'll call dr for an infinitesimal radius increment. And each of these rings then will contribute an incremental amount dE to the total electric field. So if all goes well, we should be able to compute the field contribution due to a single ring, and then we'll use integration to add up all the contributions. So before we write down the field contribution due to this ring, we need a quick note on area charge density. So area charge density is the charge per unit area measured in coulombs per square meter, and we usually give that the symbol sigma. So we can say that the area charge density for this disk is Q divided by pi r squared. That's the total amount of charge divided by the total amount of area in the disk. It's also possible to turn this expression around. So we can say the total charge in the disk is given by the area charge density sigma multiplied by the area, and that would be sigma pi r squared. And we're going to use this idea more than once as we solve this problem, that if you want the total charge, you take the area charge density and multiply it by the area. So now it's time to figure out the field contribution due to this ring of radius little r. And we start with our original formula for the electric field due to the ring of charge. And now we need to adapt this formula for the rings that we're chopping our disk into. So now we have a total field contribution that's differential, that's dE. And instead of a charge of big Q, it's an incremental charge of d little q. Finally, instead of a radius of big R for the outer radius of the disk, it's a radius of little r for the variable radius of these little rings that we're chopping the disk into. Next, we're going to use the idea that charge is area charge density multiplied by area to re-express that little dq in terms of the geometry of the ring. So instead of writing dq, we're going to have the area charge density multiplied by the area contained in that ring. And that area is given by the distance around the ring multiplied by its thickness. In other words, we're imagining cutting and unrolling this thing into a thin rectangle. And that thin rectangle would have a length of 2 pi r, that's the circumference of that little ring, and then a thickness of dr. So now that we've expressed the electric field increment in terms of this little r for the radius of one of our rings, we can use integration to add up all these contributions. So we say the total electric field is going to be the sum of all the contributions. So we write the integral of dE. So there's the integral acting as a summation device for a bunch of continuously changing infinitesimal contributions. And we plug in our expression for dE. And as I do this, I'm going to rearrange some of the constants a little bit. So I'm going to write it as sigma pi x times 2r dr. I'm keeping that factor of 2 for a good reason that we'll see in just a minute, over 4 pi epsilon 0 times x squared plus r squared to the 3/2. And we can tell by looking at the differential on this, that's dr, that this is an r integral. We're adding up all the field contributions as the radii of our rings go from 0 all the way to the outer edge of the disk at capital R. So we'll put in those limits of integration, 0 to big R. Now the sigma pi x, those are all constants. Remember, this is an R integral and x is a fixed position, so that's a constant. And the 4 pi epsilon 0 in the denominator, that's all constants. Then cancel the pi's, before I write down the next line, and then we'll move those constants out in front of the integral. So I get a sigma x over 4 epsilon 0, and then we have the integral from 0 to big R of 2r dr divided by x squared plus little r squared to the 3/2. Now the reason I kept the 2 on that r in the numerator is because I was trying to get the derivative of the interior function here. When we integrate this thing, we're going to have to use the chain rule backwards, so I needed to tack on that 2r in order to see the chain rule backwards. So when we find the antiderivative of this integrand, we're using the power rule on this expression x squared plus r squared to the negative 3/2 power. That's how we think of this 3/2 power in the denominator. So we need to add 1 to that exponent. That gives us an exponent of negative 1/2. But then we also have to divide by that resulting exponent. So I'm dividing by a negative 1/2, which is the same as multiplying by negative 2. And we evaluate this whole expression from 0 to big R. And we want to clean things up a little bit before we do this evaluation. So I'm going to cancel this factor of 2, and I end up with a minus sign out in front. So we end up with a negative sigma x over 2 epsilon 0 because we canceled that factor of 2. And then I would rather express this second term with a square root instead of a fractional exponent. So I'm going to write it as a 1 over square root x squared plus r squared. And then we're evaluating this as we go from 0 to big R, where those are the limits of integration on little r. Remember, that was the integration variable. Now, when we evaluate those limits of integration, we're going to replace little r with big R, and then we subtract the term we get by replacing little r with 0. But if I distribute the minus sign from out here in front, it would just reverse the direction of that difference. So I'm going to take care of all the minus signs at once here and write sigma x over 2 epsilon 0. And then in my first term, I'm going to sub in my lower limit instead of the upper limit, because remember, we're reversing the direction of the difference. That gives me a 1 over square root of x squared, which is just 1 over x, because we're dealing with an inherently positive quantity x here, because it represents distance. Then we subtract 1 over square root of x squared plus big R squared. Finally, I'd like to clean things up a little bit by distributing the x through those brackets. So we get sigma over 2 epsilon 0 times the quantity 1 minus x over the square root of x squared plus big R squared. All right, so there's the total electric field at a distance of x from this uniformly charged disk if we're measuring the field on the disk's axis. Now that we have the electric field due to the uniformly charged disk, we want to investigate a couple limiting cases to make sure our formula is behaving correctly. First, we take a look at the small x limit. So this is when x is much less than the radius of the disk. In other words, we're very close to the disk compared to the size of the disk. In this limit, we're so close to the disk that the field should appear to be due to an infinite sheet of charge. And to take this limit of x being much less than r, we're really focused on this term inside the square root, where we have the x squared added to r squared. If x is really much smaller than r, then the x part of that is negligible. That means that square root reduces to just r itself. And now I have 1 minus x over r, but again, x is much less than r, which means this fraction x over r is very close to 0, and that fraction itself is negligible. And so we arrive at an approximation for the electric field when x is much less than r, and that's just sigma over 2 epsilon 0. This agrees with the infinite sheet charge formula that we obtained using Gauss's law, and I'll post a link to that video at the top real quick. Next, we want to investigate the large x limit, so when x is much greater than r. In this limit, we should see that the field of the disk reduces to the field of a point charge, since getting really far from the disk will make it look like a point charge with magnitude q. And this limit actually gets really tricky. We'll start by taking a naive approach to it. And so our approach is to say, inside this square root, if x is really much bigger than r, then the r becomes negligible. That means this fraction is going to reduce to an x over x. But x over x is just 1, and then 1 minus 1 is 0. So sure, e goes to 0 as x becomes really large, but this isn't a useful result. This limit doesn't tell us anything about how the field goes to 0 as x becomes large, so we need a different approach to the problem. So let's start over, and this time what we're going to do is mess around with this fraction in order to create a really small term that allows us to use a Taylor approximation. So what I do is divide the top and bottom by x. So in that fraction, the numerator is now 1, and then the denominator is the square root of 1 plus r squared divided by x squared. That r squared divided by x squared is a very small thing because x is much larger than r. But what I recognize here is that we can use the binomial approximation on this. So I'm going to think of this as a 1 plus a small thing, that's r squared over x squared, to the negative 1/2 power. And what we're exploiting here is the Taylor series for 1 plus x raised to the n power, where x is very small. That's going to give us 1 plus n times the small thing. In other words, 1 plus our exponent, which is negative 1/2, times the small thing here, which is r squared over x squared. And those 1s are going to cancel. My minus signs cancel here because I'm subtracting this negative 1/2 term. And I'll gather the two factors of 2 together. So I end up with sigma over 4 epsilon 0 times r squared over x squared. And remember, what we're trying to do is justify that this disk is going to look like a point charge if we're far enough away from it. So what I want to do is find the total charge of the disk in this expression. Well, if I multiply the numerator by pi, that gives me pi r squared times sigma, which is the total charge on the disk. So we're going to multiply the top and bottom by pi. And again, sigma times pi r squared is the total charge on the disk, which we called capital Q. And I have Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 x squared. That's exactly the field of a point charge. So our formula for the electric field due to a uniformly charged disk is working when we get really close to the disk. It's working when we get really far from the disk. And we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.